For this curve sketching example, we're going to look at the function x cubed minus 6x squared plus 2. We're going to try to graph it, even though it's a cubic and it's kind of bigger, just using information we can find by hand. So we're going to wait and use the calculator at the very, very end just to verify our answer. We're going to try to do most of this by hand. So if we remember what it is that we can actually find by hand, there is a list of some algebra things and some calculus things. So we're going to try, as many of these as we can find, try to find the domain, the range, the intercepts, and the asymptotes. Those are algebra type things we can do for the function. And then we're going to also try to find some calculus things, like its critical values, and increasing and decreasing interval, and extrema, and concavity, and points of inflection, and things like that. So let's get started with it. We'll just go through these real quickly. And before we actually begin, let's remember, we actually don't have to have all of these, especially in the algebra column. We really do kind of need everything in the calculus column, but not everything is going to be applicable for every function in this algebra column. For example, not every function has a vertical asymptote. So, you know, some of these might be none, or we might simply just skip some. Okay, so let's start with like the x-intercept. So for that, we're going to take the function and set it equal to 0. And right off the bat, I see exactly what I'm talking about. I'm sure there probably is some places where this could be 0. And, you know, I do know some techniques that if I absolutely had to, I could find this guy's roots. You could look for the rational roots. But that's a little much for probably what is necessary for this problem. This is not very straightforward. We don't just simply take cubics and just factor them every day into, you know, three different factors. It'd be great if we easily could, but that's just not something that I think is going to be necessary for this particular problem. So if it's something pretty nasty like this, you can skip over it and you might can get away with all the other information being sufficient enough to reveal what the graph is going to look like. So I'll kind of hold this off. If we need to come back to it, we will, but we'll see if we can get away with not looking at it. All right, y-intercept, on the other hand, that's very easy. Your function was x cubed minus 6x squared plus 2, and so when you plug in 0, you get 2. Now, what does that mean? Well, that tells me a little something about this guy's graph. I know that it goes through the point 0, 2. So that's a dot on this function. Now, what else does it do? I have no idea yet, but that's at least one piece of the puzzle down. All right. Unfortunately, the domain and the range don't really help me a whole lot. With the function being a cubic or just a polynomial in general, its domain is going to be all real numbers. It's not restricted anywhere. There's nowhere that gives us division by zero or a negative under a square root because there's no fractions and there's no radicals. Also, because it's a cubic, the range is also going to be all real numbers. You get all positive y values and negative y values. So that's an example of something that's not really going to help us that much. Vertical asymptotes. This is a polynomial. Polynomials don't have any vertical asymptotes. So we'll have to say none. And again, being a polynomial, has no horizontal asymptotes. Those are usually reserved for like rational functions or whatnot. So I'll admit right off the bat, this is our first example here. And so this one is going to be a little bit more on the simpler side. We'll do some other functions later that will have some more of these things in it. But this is just kind of a good get your feet wet kind of example. So don't really have a whole lot of calculus things to go off of, algebra things to go off of. So let's move on to the calculus type things. So here's the original function. Let's start by finding the first and second derivatives because they can tell me things like points of inflection or critical values or things of that nature. So the derivative would be 3x squared minus 12x, and the second derivative would be 6x minus 12. And these two guys are going to help me immensely as far as finding out information about the function. All right, so here we go. What can f prime tell me? What can f prime tell me? Well, I know that f prime is 3x squared minus 12x. If we were to take this guy and set it equal to 0, this would give us our critical values. So we take this guy, let me slide it up a little bit. take this guy and maybe let's say factor out a common factor of 3x. You'd have 3x times the quantity x minus 4. And so I can see two places that would make the derivative be 0. 0 and 4. Both of those would make the derivative be 0. So we have a critical value at x equals 0 and x equals 4. And from the video on critical values, we know that these guys are very likely to be maxes or mins. I don't know that they are, and I don't know which they are, even if they were an extrema. But I know that there's a good shot that they could be. So what do we do from here? Well, if you recall, once you have your critical values, you typically put them on a number line, and then you pick test points before and after each one of these guys, right? So we'll pick a point before 0. How about negative 1? Between 0 and 4, how about 2? And after 4, maybe 5. And we're going to see what is the sign of the derivative. Now, why are we doing that? Well, if you remember, this will indicate if the function's increasing with a positive slope or decreasing with a negative slope. So here we go. The derivative was 3x times the quantity x minus 4. Now, let me remind you of a little trick here. If the derivative is 3x times the quantity x minus 4, I'm only really interested in the derivative being positive or negative. I don't actually care what the numerical value is. So if we look at the derivative here, if you plug in negative 1, you would get a negative times a negative, which is positive, right? That's positive. So if your first derivative is positive in this interval, that means your original function has to be increasing. That's what it means to be to have a positive slope. Now, if we know it's increasing right here at negative 1, how do we know it's not decreasing at negative 2 or changing up, down, up, down, up, down? Well, if it did ever change away from increasing, we would have found another critical value, but we found them all. There was only 2. It was just 0 and 4. All right, let's plug in 2. 3 times 2 is 6. That's positive. 2 minus 4 is negative 2. I don't really care so much about the numbers. I see that I have a positive times a negative. That'll give us a negative, indicating in this little interval our function is decreasing. And if you plug in a 5, you get a positive times a positive times a positive, indicating this is positive. Okay, and your function is increasing. Now, if you refer back to the first derivative test, if you remember what that test said, it said that if your function ever changes from increasing to decreasing, then this guy must be a relative maximum, right? Relative maximum. I mean, just think about it. Your function goes up and then goes down, and your critical value is in the middle. It's got to be a maximum. In the same way, if it goes from decreasing to increasing, your critical value must be a relative minimum. So that's great. That tells us some things about the functions. That's really good to know. Let's keep trucking, and then we'll put it all together. The second derivative was 6x minus 12. So f double prime was 6x minus 12. We set this equal to 0. We get x equals 2. Now, 2, this 2 is not a critical value. Why? Because this isn't a 0 of the first derivative. This is a 0 of the second derivative. Now, these are often points of inflection. Now, do I know that it has to be a point of inflection? No. Why? Because the definition of point of inflection was a place where the function changed concavity. So what I have to do is I have to put 2 on a number line and then see what the concavity is on both sides. Oftentimes, this will be a point of inflection, but I can't definitively say that until I try it. So let me pick something before 2, how about 1? And after 2, how about 3? All right, if you plug 1 in the second derivative, you would get a negative quantity. You plug in 3, you get a positive. Now, this does not mean increasing and decreasing. This means concave down is a negative second derivative, and concave up, that's a positive second derivative. So I'll ask you, does that mean that 2 really is a point of inflection? Absolutely. This is a point of inflection because it changes from concave down to up, because it changed concavity. There are examples out there where it might go concave down to concave down again, in which case this would not be a point of inflection, but this does change concavity, so we have a point of inflection. So now somehow we should be able to tie all this together and get a pretty accurate sketch. Now, keep in mind, this is just a sketch. This is not a perfect graph. This is just showing kind of the main look of the function. So let's start with first derivative things. I think we've accounted for all the algebra things. So I found that I had a relative max at 0 and a relative min at 4. So I know on my graph here, I'm going to have a maximum at 0 and a minimum at 4. So I know that it's going to be increasing before 0 and decreasing after 0 and increasing after 4. Now, we also have to keep in mind at the same time what the concavity is. So let's go to the second derivative. Until 2 is going to be concave down, then after 2 is going to be concave up. So let's mark 2 maybe with a different color. Okay, so here's 2 right here. Okay, so we're going to start off increasing, but in a concave down kind of way. So still increasing, still concave down. So increasing until we get to 0. And based off of the first derivative, I remember that that meant that we had a relative maximum there at 0. And then after 0, the function starts decreasing. Okay, so it's going to decrease, 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 right? Now, after 2 is still going to be decreasing, but something's going to change. What was special about 2? Ah, 2 was a point of inflection, which means it's going to change from concave down, and it's going to switch, or I'll switch colors, it's going to switch to concave up. Now, it's going to be decreasing still, but in a concave up kind of way, until you reach 4. In which case 4 was a relative min, you'll recall. Where was that? So here's 4. 4 is a relative minimum. We found that. Okay, and then it's going to continue upwards forever in a concave up kind of way, for forever, right? Now the last little detail that we have to fill in, and different instructors are more and less picky on this point. If you want a really accurate sketch, it would be kind of good to know exactly how high and exactly how low these peaks and valleys are. Some instructors, if you get the generic shape of the graph, up, down, up at the right places and whatnot, the actual Y values are not quite so important. Because if you think about this, these are big polynomials like cubics. If you plug in a number like 7, 7 cubed is massive. You're not going to actually be plugging values into that simply because the Y values are going to be so big. But nevertheless, if you wanted to, you could figure out exactly how high and exactly how low these maxes and mins are by taking their X values, like 0 and 4, and plugging them not in the first derivative, not in the second derivative, but in the original function. And when they give you an answer, those are going to be the Y values at those points. Now, 0 is for this particular problem quite easy because we already did this one. This has a height of 2, but if you plugged in 4, it would be a very large negative number, and I'll leave it for you to do that. Okay, so now we're done. We're done. This is a accurate sketch of this very large cubic polynomial. I just find this very impressive that we can do this. Now, what I typically do when we're done is I'll go down here, and here's an actual sketch from my TI of what the function actually looks like. And you see, it's very, very accurate. It was increasing up to 0, and then you had a relative maximum, in fact, at 0, and then it went down, down, down until you got to 2. So here's 2. 2 was a point of inflection. Then it continued to be decreasing until you had a relative minimum at 4, which is interesting. Then after 4 is concave, or after 2, in fact, is concave up, but it starts increasing after 4 and continues forever. So we got this highly accurate graph simply by hand. All right, so if you want to now, you can move on to our next video, which has a slightly more complicated function.